Welcome to Around Town, featuring what's going on here in the greater Concord area. I am your host, Dick Patton, and we're now in the spring season, so goodbye to winter and stay there until next January or whatever. But now we're also getting ready for Easter and Passover, and I can't believe that hopefully we've had our last snowstorm. But today I'm so happy to have with me my usual sidekick here, Paul Brogan, and just think, Easter's, the baskets are all in the, have been in the stores for about a month now, some cases 2 months, but, and I haven't been by Granite State Candy yet. Do they have the big chocolate bunny in the window yet?
I haven't been on Warren Street in 6 months, I don't think. I don't know. I would assume by now they must, with it, what, 4 weeks away, I think.
Yeah, it's on April 16th, I think it is.
Yeah, something like that.
Because we're working on the Easter egg hunt that we're bringing back because the city of Concord did away with it, and at least for the Heights area. And April 15th is the day we're doing it on Saturday, the day before Easter.
Nice.
Well, it is if the weather cooperates.
Yes.
And so we're working on that and getting that ready.
Well, since the last time I was on 2 weeks ago, a lot has happened with the weather. We, while we're officially in spring, a week ago we had a nor'easter, when I was here 2 weeks ago, it felt like April already.
Well, we had bare ground there from, was it February 14th or around Valentine's, and got a taste of that, 15.6 inches of snow.
Yes.
But March is known for that.
It is.
And April is too.
Yes.
We've had some good snowstorms in April.
We have. I remember Easter egg hunting at White's Park many years ago in the snow. You know, they would, Betty Abbott and her group had put the eggs around, and fortunately you could see them because of the colors of them, but but we were trotting through the snow trying to find them. So here, maybe by May 1st, we can comfortably say it's over with, but anything's a possibility up to then.
I was talking with Chris Pappas today, and of course the Kiwanis getting ready for their fair, of course, which is 2 months away, and it's not till May 17th it opens up at the arena. And I was saying, gosh, don't think it seem possible that we're already thinking of the Kiwanis Fair. You know, and of course, as he said, of course, they lost a really a valued member. Charlie Averill died a few weeks ago, and he was such a nice guy, and he was part of the Kiwanis for so many years, and he would go down there, one of those dedicated members, and the waterfront park that they have, the Kiwanis have, he'd be down there raking up, cleaning the dump and trash, and and unfortunately, the poor guy, I guess, had dementia really bad. And so he's passed on. You know, we lost Doug Black there, Dr. Black, another one. You know, some of the old-timers in Concord really is cashing their chips in. But
absolutely.
And so it's been a rough winter all the way around, and I hope that this is the last storm we have now. I'm ready for spring.
Me too.
You know?
Yes.
But
at least the days have gotten longer. Evening, it doesn't get dark, and that psychologically, I think, just feels a little bit hopeful and optimistic.
You figure they've got 2 more weeks, I think, in Florida or Arizona for the baseball teams. And Michigan, boy, go blue. They're in the March Madness, Sweet 16 now, so hopefully when this show goes on, that they'll be in the top eight or whatever, but they came from nowhere. So, you know, it's all coming down to April. And
the Grange has their awards in April.
That's coming up on April 17th is the awards night when we do the outstanding police officer, teacher, and firefighter, among others. And we haven't got the teacher one yet or the firefighters, so waiting for those to come in. But I know it's all of a sudden we're resuming meetings, and of course the egg hunt is one of the big first projects right off the bat. But you know, it just doesn't seem possible. And then before you know it, June will be here.
It will.
Time for graduations.
Absolutely.
And all that stuff again. Memorial Day. It's like, Where has time gone?
It's scary, and I think as we mature, it goes even more quickly. Our parents are, you know, used to say, "Don't wish your life away," because when you get older, it's going to go quickly, and I think that is true, that it is indeed.
And you made the newspapers this week in the Insider with the
Oh,
Concord
not the
Theater
police
thing.
log. Okay,
Concord
good.
Theater, big write-up there. Of course, that you provided them with some information, and you know, it's really good though. It's nice that they're giving you credit for maintaining that history of it.
Well, it's
You know.
important. It's much like what you do, and I go on the Grange page and read, you know, the things that you write. But I think being a historian about parts of our community is really important because they get waylaid so easily. I mean, I've mentioned it before, but a couple of years ago when we had our 250th, now there was nothing that was a definitive record of what goes on. It was written, you know, everything was written and presented in such a way to highlight little things, but nowhere was the Concord Theater referenced. The Grange was,
We weren't
you know,
talked about.
and the fact that the Grange has continued the traditions of the Christmas tree lighting, the parade, all of these things, all of that was left out.
None
So
of
if somebody's new to Concord and doesn't understand all of that, then they're never going to have an understanding of the important role certain things, you know, played in our history.
I know it, and it's sad because that's the problem. See, they look at us like we're a bunch of old farmers, while some organizations, because they serve wine and crackers and cheese at their meetings, they're the high kalupi. But the Granges, of course, they have a ruling that they are very anti-alcohol at their meetings. Now, they may have a drink out at a banquet or a dinner, but in their meeting halls, there is no alcohol presented. But it's right. I mean, we just we don't get the recognition that we should.
No.
But either way, I mean, the people appreciate. I assume they appreciate what we do for the community. And like I said, we're all looking for something to offer. But you know, I mean, we don't have the Mr. Concord pageant and all that stuff. But you know, I mean, it's, I don't know. But anyway, kids now are getting ready for graduation. Well, they're not ready for graduation yet,
No.
but they are applying for scholarships and all that
Yes.
stuff, the senior class, and you know, so it just doesn't seem possible. Now we're coming into that last quarter
Yes,
of
very
the
true.
year.
Very true. But as you said about Easter, again, when we were kids, you know, Easter wasn't even mentioned until after Lent had started and, you
Oh,
know,
I know.
well into it, and you didn't. But in this case, you know, Easter things have been out there since the minute Valentine's candy went, it was replaced by Easter, even though it was more than 2 months
Oh, I
away.
know.
And it sort of takes away the
Yeah,
fun
it does.
and the anticipation of it because it becomes almost routine. You just see it and you're used to seeing it. And by the time Easter is over, they'll have, you know, they'll have pushed on to something else. And, you know, everything is in too much of a rush.
It
And
is.
then you don't get to savor the immediacy of it.
No, because I mean, I in a way it's not really funny, but you figure that places that are rushing out the pansies and petunias and all that stuff, and they kind of hide them back because you can't plant them in the snow.
Exactly.
So, you know, that kind of put a damper on that stuff,
It
but.
did. Because before that last storm, people had spring fever and they were ready to start mowing their grass just
Oh,
about. It was that.
yes, they
And
are up
then
there.
this was a real reality check. But those of us who have been here for a long time recognize that. No, don't be, you know, don't be fooled by today because tomorrow may be totally different.
That's right.
And it does happen
Exactly.
that way quite a bit, so.
I know. And you start thinking about summertime and, you know, wondering how the apple trees and all that, it doesn't seem, it just keeps running on rolling along. And
Exactly. It does. It really
but
does.
look at the river. You figure it was all froze over. Then we had that big warm spell, unthawed, but then now it froze back up
Back
again.
over
Now
again.
it's opened up again,
Yes,
so.
and then I guess in the next couple of days it'll probably freeze over again. We're supposed to have cold temperatures and wind chills again. So,
you remember, I think we talked about this, but do you remember that Granite State used to have the hollow eggs with your names printed on it?
Yes.
I was telling a lady that the other day, we were in a store, and I don't know where it was, and we were talking about Easter, and I said, yes, they said Granite State used to have hollow chocolate eggs mm-hmm. with your name in mm-hmm. printed in white frosting on it.
Yes.
And we thought that was a big deal,
mm-hmm.
you know, get your name on it.
Yes.
My folks used to get all my cousins and us kids an egg with our names on it.
The Easter Bunny would bring it to us. It was their yep. Easter morning, yep. and that was part of the surprise that day. But you did expect that it was going to happen. And and in my head, I would think, oh, the bunny stopped at Granite State Candy and got this. And, you know, you really believe that's what happened. So.
And we used to have, there used to be a lot of Easter shows on, but you don't see them anymore.
Nothing anymore. Very, very little.
I mean, of course, yes, we had Lawrence Welk, who always had his Easter show, much like the Christmas show.
Yes, yes.
And then you had the cartoons, the Easter Bunnies coming to town, Peter Rabbit, and mm-hmm. The first Easter Bunny they used to have out there. They had those out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, unless you see them on the Disney Channel or whatever, you don't see them out much anymore.
No, no. And Hallmark doesn't really do any movies around Easter time, it doesn't seem.
But you can go on this week and vote for your favorite Christmas Hallmark movie.
You can?
Yes, they're going to. They got it started, I think, now by the time this comes on, but Ian will have this on YouTube, but I think they're having 10 days worth of voting or something of movies, Christmas movies that you can vote on, and if you get picked or whatever, you could get some kind of a prize or something. But yes, they're going.
Now, these the Christmas movies that were shown this past.
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay. I don't even remember. I mean, anything particular? They all, after a while, sort of run in together.
They all have about the same theme.
Yes.
You know, I will say one thing, at least it's going to have a good ending.
Happy ending, right.
Yeah,
yes.
It's not going to be a blood and gut type ending.
So maybe they'll show some of those during Christmas in July, the ones that won or get the most votes.
That could be, too. Yes, because they do have 10 days in July when they show all Christmas movies again.
Yes.
To get everybody ready for after Labor Day when they start advertising again.
Well, because it starts the end of October.
Oh, yeah, it starts before Halloween.
Yes. It is amazing. It really is there.
You know, it's true because, you know, you look down at the stores and day after Valentine's, they had all these carts of candy that was half price. And
and now all the summer clothes are out. The clearance of the winter.
Yep.
And it's time to get your summer clothes. Yep. And by the time you're settling into summer, the fall sweaters will be starting
to appear. Yeah.
It and I think it tended, before there were the chains, Marshall's and TJ and Burlington, etc., when it was just family-owned businesses, like the Manises own Mark E. and things like that, I think they had more control over it. And I think because it personally would bother them to have Christmas stuff out in September or October, they wouldn't do it until... The same with the Silvermans and the Varsity Shop and the Junior Deb. They wouldn't do that. So it was more special when it finally happened. And I think that's one of the things you lose when you don't have your family run businesses. And everything is, less personal.
Yeah.
But it's,
when you talk about them, those families, I was looking at some pictures the other day in a book somewhere, and it was showing Main Street and all that, and I saw some of the signs there from different stores, and I thought, oh my gosh, that's right, I forgot about them. But I wonder then, when you mention, I wonder, are the Silvermen still living?
I don't know.
The kid, Don must be. That was one of the sons who ran it after his dad retired. But I wondered if he was still alive, or his brother Lewis, who did the Varsity Show, or where they are now.
Yeah, the granddaughter's made a good name for herself.
Oh, really?
Sarah Silverman.
She's
an actress and a comic.
Oh, really?
And she was raised in Manchester.
Oh,
and that's
for goodness
her
sake.
That's her grandparents were the Silvermans.
Oh, I didn't know
yes.
that.
She made a speech at the Democratic Convention that went over very well, and I don't remember specifically what it was to the Bernie supporters to grow up or something that. I've seen her at various times in different things, and I guess she's made a few movies and done very well for herself.
Hmm.
Much like, you know, a few other people from, Adam Sandler, of course, was from Manchester, and the late show host is from Manchester.
Not Jimmy Kimmel.
No.
Not Jay Leno.
But somebody else was on in the next hour.
I know. I'm trying to place where it
was. And he comes back to New Hampshire periodically. Hmm. I think he came back to do a benefit for his high school in Manchester, because Bob Baines, who used to be the mayor of Manchester, had been the principal at the time that he was there. So, but Concord hasn't spawned as many that have, you know, become.
No.
Well, you and I.
Oh, I know.
But,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
legends in our own minds.
There we go. Sure, but, yes, I know, yeah, that's true.
But beyond that, historians, I mean, if people want to know anything about the history of this community, we certainly have the answers for that and can certainly describe it in vivid terms. That's one of the things people also say when they say, oh, I saw you and Dick. It was an interesting show, is the fact that they said, you're like cheerleaders for the community. Mm. And he said, you make it sound very alive and real and describe it in such a way that it's possible to close your eyes and actually picture it.
Mm.
And I think that's true.
But you mention that to somebody and they say, oh, I'm so sick of hearing about the past. Who wants to hear about the past? Well, some people, I mean, the sad part is people who move into the community today,
yes.
they have no idea.
No.
Of what went on here years ago. Do they care? Probably not.
But there may be a few who do. I mean,
yeah,
you know, the foundation of this community, the railroad and all of that, is important to understand.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you just get a warped impression of the community or people that have lived here a long time and don't understand the bedrock on which everything was built and why things are...
Well, they were talking about, I know they recently had a story about Store Street, and I got on the phone and I called City Hall and I said, what's going to happen with the railroad tracks? You know, I mean, I hope we're not going to lose our railroads.
The last bit that we
have. That's right. And they said, no, but they did close the northern rail line up through Bosquen, up through Andover, that way to up to Lebanon. But, you know, but the other one, they're still keeping alive. And I said, well, I would hope so, because as far as I'm concerned, the current operator of that line, the one down from Concord South, does nothing to promote the railroad in Concord. I don't care. They've been at meetings I've been at, and they don't do anything as far as promoting it.
No.
They don't want to see passenger rail in here. They don't want to see freight in here. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's sad because this was like a mecca for all the trains
coming into Concord.
But
and I would take a train to Boston before I'd ever drive down.
Oh, I would too.
Because you would pay for your fare just what you would pay for parking in Boston.
Mm.
Not to mention the convenience of getting on a train, being able to read or relax while you get down there, and not having the stress of traffic everything else. And there's something about rail that buses can't ever be compared to, because
I know it.
The smoothness of the ride, but also just the
I love the ride in the train.
It is. And the sound almost lulls you into a sense of peace.
Yeah.
You know, of the wheels on the track.
It's
and there's no stopping and starting or slowing down for And it's just, you know, a totally different thing. And I'm sure, you know, I used to, years ago, talk to people who said the same thing about the streetcar system in Concord.
Yep.
Before buses, that it was a joy to ride the streetcar because it went everywhere. It went up Washington Street, down Center Street. Sure. You could get anywhere in the city on the streetcar line.
Yep.
And they said buses just don't do the same thing.
The diesel smell and all that stuff.
Yes, exactly. And the ones we used to have 45, 50 years ago, the smell was you know, it was horrific. So, but there just seems to be an inability to see, you know, what a return to rail service could do, whereas other places have jumped on.
I know, and it's amazing how we're so
behind.
Yeah,
we're so stuck in the mud.
That's right.
Where it's it was the same with streetcars. There's been like 20 cities in the country in the last 5 years that have put streetcars in, and in almost every case, it has been a huge boom.
Yeah.
Also for development, because people know that if I build something along a streetcar line, it's going to be there in 5 or 10 years. It's not like you can change a bus route and suddenly it's not there.
Yeah.
But there seems to be a reluctance to really and truly say this would be a way, if we want to bring younger people into the state or show some vitality, that would be one of the things that I think would work.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. It just amazes me that how they're so afraid to do this or that. But no, I did. I called City Hall the other day and I said, "What's going on with, you know, this?" Yeah. I see that they're going to. Nope, he said, "No, they're going to keep those rail lines there. They'll work around, but they do want to." And of course, you see, we have a barbershop coming to on Lower on Sword Street now for men that you can sit there and have a cocktail. Or a glass of beer when you have a haircut down near Cheers on Lower Avenue.
Oh.
They've got one in Manchester. It was a front page of the Monitor. Nick Reed did a story on it. It was called Codex or something like that, of Nashville or something. And they're building one in Concord. And they think it's going to make a go here. Mm. You can go in and get your hair cut and sit there and have the bartender get you up a drink or whatever. And, you know.
Wow.
Yes. So I'm
come
you.
A long way since the old barber pole.
I know. Goodness gracious. We used to go down there on Store Street Extension. Uh-huh. I mean, Pleasant Street Extension. My father would take me down
underneath the Endicott. There was a barber shop.
Yeah, well, we were on the other side where the two brothers were.
Oh, okay. Yes,
Their building is still there.
Uh-huh.
What's left of it. Yep. Because there was the Pleasant Street Cafe next to that.
Okay.
And then there was the two brothers. They had their barbershop there. And, of course, that was the days when they'd be smoking. And, my goodness.
Yeah.
Just about choking, you know, your hair and blow the smoke in your face. And, oh, my gosh.
Wow.
And then they split up, they did. And one brother went opened up a barbershop on the Heights where the old Heights Market was.
Yes.
The original Heights Market.
Right.
On the corner of Thomas Street and Loudon Road. They had a men's barbershop on one side, then a ladies'
salon
on the other. And that's where he went. But then I don't know, I'm sure they're both long gone now, but they were two barbers over there. They had quite a business there.
Oh, we had quite a few barbers in Concord back then.
We've got quite a few now again.
Yeah, we do. Yeah. They've really come back into vogue in the last 10 or 15 years.
Yeah.
Because I think guys didn't want to be paying $40, $45 to get their hair cut.
Really,
they wanted something more basic and simple without all the frills. And I think that's what, you know, did it.
And I was looking at Sacred Heart. They had some pictures of the inside of
Sacred
Heart.
And the monitor, yes.
And I still say, I think it's sad. I just can't, and yet the price.
Yeah.
Those condos are going to be so brutal.
Yes.
But
it would take your whole year's salary doing this show.
I get nothing for it. Yeah, it's volunteer. But I just can't imagine, though.
It just
still looks like a church to me.
It does.
I don't
and
care
it'll always
how much,
be Sacred Heart Church.
I don't care how much you dress it up. It still looks like a church.
Yeah, it does. St. Peter's still sits up there. Nobody has.
Well, they had said that the diocese was close to signing papers for that. I don't know if it's.
Not according to all the insiders that I have checked with.
Yeah, they can't wait. They got to wait till after that shelter closes down. Mm. But still, mm-hmm. I know. And there's another the biggest church supposedly in Concord.
Yeah,
and just sits there and says, mm-hmm. "Please, somebody take me," you know, or whatever. But
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't know. But it's sad.
It is.
But yeah, I was talking the other day too. So we were talking about establishments, and I said. Nobody remembers the old Harvard restaurant on Loudon Road.
Oh, yes.
You remember that?
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, no, that's what I said. Nobody remembers. I said, I do. It was the hot spot on Friday and Saturday.
Yes, it was. Cars and motorcycles and everything else. Mobbed. Yes.
Police were up there.
Never went in, but went by it. And yeah, you're right. There would often be blue flashing lights.
Boy, they'd be up there.
They would be.
And then, of course, down the road was Millie's.
Yes. Yes.
And they changed it to Tap Room.
Yep.
Or whatever.
Yep.
The dry or whatever. But yeah, it was
that. That was popular too.
Yeah, those days.
Oh, that area was.
I mean, we had those two compared to the Carlene's downtown.
Right, exactly.
You know,
and then there was another one on Depot Street that was
it wasn't
Phillips.
Phillips. Phillips.
Wasn't it Phillips restaurant, I think.
Yeah.
Where the pizza place was for a while.
Mm.
Yeah, and which always had a lot of liquor smell emanating from that. But it had frosted windows, so when you walked by, you couldn't look in. But you just got this whiff of, and periodically someone would stumble out. But, but it wasn't a place us children were. We weren't supposed to go down Depot Street. That was not. You go on over one block to Pleasant Street if you need to go down there.
Mm.
But there really wasn't much of a reason. As little children, the railroad station wouldn't be a reason to really go down there. Afterwards, when the Capitol Shopping Center, I liked to go to Britt's because they had a great record department.
Oh, really?
The record department in the annex was, you know, just about
that.
Every record you could want.
Yeah, I remember that now.
But that's what was out in the annex. And, of course, as you came in the other door was Polly Susan's and luncheon counter.
Yes.
But their luncheon counter never felt like a real luncheon counter like Newberry's did.
No, not with Millie up there.
And there was no squeaky floor in Brits. And you missed those little touches that, Millie was amazing. She knew everybody's name.
Oh,
she knew what
yes.
they wanted. Before they sat down, she had your beverage ready.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
She knew which pies to order.
Yes.
Because I know so-and-so likes apple or whatever.
Or custard or something else.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it was amazing. It was an experience to go in there and to listen to the other people at the counter, the conversations. You learned so much about what was going on, as much as you'd learn in the newspaper and then some, because people openly shared their feelings and talked to the staff and, you know.
And I never went downstairs there either much as a kid.
I only did at Christmas time because that's where all the Christmas things were, in the basement.
Oh, really?
They had a whole Christmas section.
You know, they had dishes down there and stuff, but
yes.
I never went down there too much.
Well,
I can tell you it doesn't seem possible. Well, we're going down to 10 seconds again.
Okay.
The day, the half hour's
where
gone
does
again.
The time go?
I know, really. And of course, we probably put Ian to sleep over there, but you know. No, look at the education he's getting.
Absolutely.
All this history for nothing.
For nothing.
I'm telling you.
Well, thank you, Dick.
Yes, thank you, Paul, for coming on, and I hope you have a great rest of the March. We'll see
thank
you.
You
again in a couple of weeks for Easter and Passover and all that stuff.
I look forward to it. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks to Ian Marks, my super director there, and thanks for joining us. And again, we're always looking for your comebacks or whatever you'd like to give us some your information. We'd love to hear your comments. So I'm Dick Patton. Enjoy the good weather, and we'll see you all soon on Around Town.